This lesson will focus on the key theoretical concepts related to hypothesis testing. After completing this lesson, you'll be able to explain the differences between null and alternative hypotheses and describe the two primary concerns that we should be aware of when testing a hypothesis. Let's begin by differentiating between the two main types of hypotheses that we'll use in a hypothesis testing. The majority of statistical tests that are run are referred to as null hypothesis significance testing. With null hypothesis significance testing, we are able to determine the probability that a relationship exists between two or more variables by first establishing that a null relationship does not exist between those variables. This may seem backward, but we do this because we're better at estimating what the data would look like if the relationship did not exist, as opposed to estimating what it would look like if the relationship did exist. Put simply, as stated here, our best tools only know how to show that something is false. Therefore, we will start off with the assumption that a null relationship exists in our models, then use the data we have to try to disprove that statement. This process is what's known as null hypothesis significance testing. As previously stated, the null hypothesis states that there is no relationship between the variables being examined. Another way to put this is that we are hypothesizing that the data in the model is no different from what we would expect based on chance alone. On the other hand, the true hypothesis that we are really interested in is referred to as the alternative or research hypothesis. This states that there is a relationship between the variables in the model. When we use our statistical test to show that the null hypothesis is false, we're able to determine the probability associated with the alternative hypothesis being supported. This is typically what the hypothesis testing flowchart looks like. The first three boxes in the flowchart relate to activities that are done before data are even collected. In this class, we will focus on the steps that are completed after collecting data. The first step mentioned midway through the flowchart is calculating the statistic and identifying the p-value. With any inferential statistical analysis that you run, you'll be given a test statistic. In this class, we'll be working with chi-square, t-test, and f-value test statistics. After calculating any of these, you can use a table of critical values to determine a probability value, or p-value. The p-value will show you the likelihood of finding a test statistic that large based on the sample size in your data. If your p-value is less than 0.05, it means that there is less than a 5% probability that your test statistic would be that large. You can then reject the null hypothesis and infer that it is unlikely that a null relationship exists between the variables in your model. On the other hand, if your p-value is equal to or greater than 0.05, then there is a greater than 5% probability that you would find a test statistic that size. You would therefore fail to reject the null hypothesis and conclude that, based on your current data, you cannot state that a relationship exists between the variables in your model. Here is a summary of the decisions you would make based on whether or not your test statistic is statistically significant, meaning that your p-value is larger than 0.05. It is important to note that you do not have the option of accepting the null. We never try to prove that the null is true. Your only two possible options are to reject the null or fail to reject the null. Now that you have an understanding of the differences between the null and alternative hypotheses, let's talk about some concerns with hypothesis testing. The first concern with the hypothesis testing process relates to practical and statistical significance. This should be a review for you as we discussed it in the critical thinking section. The important thing to note here is there are two main ways to talk about the significance of a test. We often focus on statistical significance, which relates to the size of the p-value. However, we can also discuss the practical significance of the test, which relates to the size of the effect. In this course, you will learn how to do calculations to determine both practical and statistical significance, as both should be interpreted to get a better understanding of the true relationship between the variables in your model. The importance of examining both practical and statistical significance lies in the fact that statistical significance is strongly influenced by sample size. This means that very small, meaningless effects could easily become statistically significant if the size of the sample is fairly large. This would result in some meaningless effect being given too much importance or attention. An example of this was seen earlier in our lectures when I discussed the rare case of developing archaeomelanitis from chewing toothpicks, which is an effect that was statistically significant, but not practically significant. Statistical significance being strongly influenced by sample size could also mean that a meaningful effect could be overlooked. This could occur if a study had too small of a sample size, resulting in a non-significant finding. Ignoring a finding for not being statistically significant could mean missing an effect that is actually practically significant. To summarize, it is therefore important to determine and interpret both the statistical and practical significance of any statistical test that you run. The second concern with hypothesis testing relates to type 1 and 2 errors. Type 1 and 2 errors are also known as false positives and false negatives. The positive in this statement means concluding that a relationship is present, whereas the negative relates to concluding that a relationship is absent. Therefore, a false positive means that we are falsely stating that a relationship is present, whereas a false negative means that we are falsely stating that a relationship is absent. An analogy from law is provided here that may help you differentiate between these two concepts. In the case of a false positive, you would use the evidence provided in the courtroom to falsely convict someone, whereas for a false negative, you would use the evidence provided in the courtroom to falsely state that the person is not guilty, hence missing their guilt. Another analogy that may help is thinking of a false positive as getting on the wrong plane, whereas a false negative is similar to missing your flight. Take a moment to think about which error would be worse: running a test and having a conclusion be a false positive or having it be a false negative. Before you get too comfortable with your answer, watch the following clip from Newsy on PSA testing.
The United States Preventative Services Task Force sparked controversy after giving women in their 40s some words of wisdom: don't get an annual mammogram. And that panel is at the center of controversy again, this time with a suggestion for men. Fox has more.
And a key government health panel is now advising that healthy men should no longer receive those PSA blood tests that check for prostate cancer because the test may offer more harm than good.
According to the American Cancer Society, studies have shown no evidence that PSA or protein-specific antigen tests are lifesavers. If anything, they say they are the exact opposite. The New York Times explains. From 1986 through 2005, 1 million men received surgery, radiation therapy, or both who would not have been treated without a PSA test. Among them, at least 5,000 died soon after surgery, and 10,000 to 70,000 suffered serious complications. As a result of these complications, the man who developed the test has called its widespread use a public health disaster. Health officials say 1 in 6 men will get prostate cancer, a normally slow-growing illness. And aside from death, a survivor could end up impotent and incontinent from testing and treatment. A CNN reporter says it's those factors that could have the majority of men staying away from the test.
Begin with, cancers usually are very slow-growing, and they're not going to hurt you. Mm-hmm. So you might find this slow-growing prostate cancer when you go to look for it, and then you treat it, and you can make a man impotent and incontinent with the treatment when the cancer was never going to hurt him to begin with.
On the other end of the controversy is the group of people who argue, in the end, the PSA tests are worth it.
PSA has shown that over the last 10, 15 years, there's a decrease in death and mortality.
Because PSA testing is not 100% accurate, doesn't mean we should not do it. I mean, it has still made a major impact upon us having people with detecting their cancers at a much earlier stage, in a stage that can be treated successfully.
Adding to the controversy is the cash. A blogger for the New America Foundation says the task force is more concerned with saving the government money, and the real problem is that medical personnel are pushing the test too much. The marketing departments of many hospitals openly admit that they offer free PSA testing as a means of bringing in new paying customers. According to the chief medical officer of the American Cancer Society, some physicians have openly complained that any criticism of PSA testing could hurt their wallets by cutting down on the number of patients diagnosed. Adding to that, the recommendations have an effect on the government. A Washington Post health editor featured on PBS NewsHour says,
insurance companies look at what the panel recommends and decide what they should pay for. And in fact, under the health care, the federal health care reform legislation that passed, this panel has actually become more influential because some of the basic benefits that the federal government will require under the health reform legislation will be influenced by this panel's recommendations.
The panel sought to make it clear that this is just a proposal draft. The recommendations are open for public comment, and the final report will be released next week. For Newsy, I'm Christy Lewis.
There are no easy answers to this question. It really does depend on the context. Within the context of PSA tests, more false positives on prostate cancer could lead to men receiving treatments which may do more harm than good. In such a context with a slow-growing cancer, a false positive may be worse than a false negative. On the other hand, with a faster-growing, more life-threatening cancer, false negatives may be worse than false positives. An important question to ask is which error would be worse based on the context in which you're analyzing data. After establishing an appropriate answer to that question, you can determine if you're engaging in any of the following practices which would increase the chance of making these errors. The first factor that could increase your chance of making a type 1 or 2 error relates to violating the assumptions associated with the data analytics strategy being used. If this is done, you could incur either a type 1 or 2 error, meaning you could either find something that isn't really there or fail to find a relationship that really does exist. In this course, we will discuss 3 types of statistical analyses. These are chi-square tests, correlation, and regression. Each of these analyses are associated with their own set of assumptions about the distribution of the data. These assumptions will be discussed in greater detail in each topic, but it is important to note here that if you run an analysis that is not appropriate for the scale of measurement of the data or the shape of the distribution, you would be violating the assumptions of the test and would therefore not be able to interpret the results. The second factor that could increase your chance of making a type 1 error relates to running a one-tail test. Typically, when we run a statistical analysis, we assume that our 5% probability of error is distributed across both tails of our distribution, such that there is a 2.5% probability that the relationship between the variables in our model is much higher than what we would expect by chance, and a 2.5% probability that the relationship between the variables in our model is much lower than what we would expect by chance. This is referred to as a two-tail test and is the default model when running a statistical test. However, a data analyst may choose to run a one-tail test. This may be done if they're concerned about having a false negative. However, they will do so at the risk of finding more false positives. As shown in the table here, you can see that for one-tail tests, it takes a much smaller t statistic in order to have the test be statistically significant, or fall in the less than 5% range. With a one-tail test, the t value needs to be only greater than 2.132 in order to be significant, whereas for a two-tail test, the absolute value of t needs to be larger than 2.776 in order to be significant. Based on these differences, a one-tail test is associated with a greater likelihood of false positives than a two-tail test. The third factor that could increase your chance of making a type 1 or 2 error relates to the alpha level that you choose. Typically, we set alpha at 0.05, meaning that we accept a 5% chance of error in our results and have a 95% level of confidence in the accuracy of our results. If the p-value of our test is less than 5%, we consider it significant. However, if the p-value is larger than 0.05, then there is a greater than 5% chance of error in our results, and our test would not be considered statistically significant. Depending on the context in which you're analyzing data, you might find that a false negative is much worse than a false positive. In such a case, you may choose to increase your cutoff for significance to 0.10 or 10%, which would make it easier to detect an effect. On the other hand, in a different context, you may find that a false positive is much worse than a false negative. In such a case, you may choose to decrease your cutoff for significance to 0.01 or 1%, which would make it more difficult to detect an effect. The final factor that could increase your chance of making a type 1 error is the number of statistical tests conducted. As previously mentioned, we accept a 5% chance of error with any statistical test that we run. However, if we run two statistical tests, the probability that the findings from the first test was due to error is 5%, and the probability that the second test was due to error is an additional 5%. Using the addition rule of probability, across both tests, the probability of our results being due to error is 5 plus 5, which is 10%. The same can be said if we run three tests, as shown in the example here. Two ways to get around this problem is to 1. Use a more powerful test that runs several comparisons in one go. For example, instead of running different comparisons with multiple t-tests, it would be better to run just one ANOVA. And 2. Use what is called the Bonferroni adjustment, in which we divide our alpha level by the number of tests that we plan to run and use that value as the cutoff for significance for each test. For example, if we ran three analyses, we would use a cutoff of 0.05 divided by 3, that is 0.017, to determine the significance of the test as opposed to a cutoff of 0.05. These are the key theoretical concepts that you will need to know in this course as they relate to hypothesis testing.